laser detect Pearl Harbor by air.
Ask not what your country can do.
Kennedy has been shot.
One small step for man.
These truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
More people now visit the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington than any other single site in the nation's capital. But even before it was dedicated in 1982, it was the subject of bitter debate. Everything about the war in Vietnam was controversial.
People who had been drafted to fight in that very unpopular war were actually blamed for having participated in it. I saw some of these troops coming home from Vietnam booed and hissed on the docks of San Francisco. A very shocking sight.
Indeed, it was the Vietnam veterans themselves, not the government, who began the memorial project. It was designed by a 22-year-old Yale student named Maya Lin. Its austere simplicity came as a shock. On the wall, the names of all the Americans who died in Vietnam. Every day, friends and loved ones, wives and children come here to make a connection.
When I finally got there to the wall, I was panicked that I didn't see his name. And I thought for a moment, maybe he's not here. Maybe they've left him out. And so I'm searching, and the minute I finally locked my eyes on his name, William A. Branch, and it almost felt like maybe that I was looking at myself for the very first time, maybe as his daughter, and I never really saw myself that way before.
Among those who leave mementos and tributes at the wall are the Vietnam veterans who survived. Dennis Mannion was there on Veterans Day in 1982 when the wall was dedicated.
I just had to go. I knew people who were going to be on this wall. William Huff, Michael Hiller, Jim Rice, Benjamin Fordham, Malcolm Mole, Melvin Rimmel. I mean, I knelt right down in the ground when I saw Malcolm Mole and Melvin Rimmel. The last time I saw either one of them, I was kneeling next to the bags that they were in.
Behind every name, there's a story.
Captain Hartley, a real gung-ho guy, and he just couldn't wait to get into combat. That was his biggest goal. I remember his tank going by and he was covered, but he used to wear these skin-tight black gloves. And you could see this arm going by with the black glove on the hand, and I was crushed.
You can see your reflection in the wall. They have your own image somehow superimposed behind the names. Is eerie and also comforting in that you can be with friends one more time.
America lost the war in Vietnam. In 1975, the North Vietnamese took over. In 1979, the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan. And as the 80s began, what many identified as communism was gaining ground in Africa and Central America. a new form of anti-Americanism was spreading throughout much of the Muslim world. At home, Americans were mired in economic problems, sky-high inflation, interest rates over 20%. The country was discouraged. But Ronald Reagan, with his infectious optimism, persuaded Americans that their country could overcome the humiliation of Vietnam and was destined again to be as it had once been, the world's military, economic, even, he said, the moral leader. On January the 20th, 1981, Ronald Wilson Reagan became America's 40th president.
Reagan came in at exactly the right time. They wanted someone who represented the older, better, stronger America.
He made people feel good about being Americans with that whole idea that everything's fine and you know, everything's under control.
But only 2 months after the inauguration, the country's newfound sense of hope and purpose seemed suddenly in danger.
It was just unbelievable. Just shocking. We just couldn't believe what had happened.
We have word from George Washington Hospital that President Reagan may not live.
And then it turned out that the next day that he survived the bullet and he was actually joking with doctors. And it just kind of added to the Superman myth of Reagan, I think.
Within a month, the president was looking hale and hearty again and talking up the future.
We have much greatness before us. We can restore our economic strength and build opportunities like none we've ever had before.
Ronald Reagan's answer to double-digit inflation, record unemployment, and high interest rates was fewer regulations, lower taxes, and less money for social programs. The immediate effect was a brutal recession. Daryl McDaniels of the rap group Run DMC grew up in Hollis, Queens, in New York City.
It was really a close-knit type community. Everybody knew everybody. You knew every kid, you knew every uncle, you knew the name of every dog and cat on the block.
But hit by the recession, inner city neighborhoods deteriorated. Homelessness became a prominent feature of urban life. Listen to Daryl McDaniels.
When I came off the road in 1986, I mean, it looked like a war zone, like a battle zone, like somebody dropped a bomb.
These are the words that I wrote, so I hope that they know, man. I never joke about the coke that the smoke can. Understand your
finger. The bomb was crack, cocaine in the form of a rock. This new scourge first came to public attention in 1983. It was cheap, it was instantly addictive, and it was devastating in its effects.
You're gonna be fine.
You know, I came off the road and I'm like, oh, that's homeboy's sister. And I'm like, what happened to her? Yo, she's fiending out. Yo, she's cracked out. She's, you know, selling her body and she's doing everybody in the neighborhood. What? Yo, it's because of crack, man. It's because of crack.
Crack turned addicts into predators.
Yo, she robbed her mother, and he robbed her father, and he killed his brother, and this and that. And I was like, oh my God.
The population in America's ghettos was decimated by jail and death. Violent crime rose by 33% during the decade. Drug dealing became a quick way to riches for those with few other opportunities.
The drug dealers had two things. They had money and they had power. Because you look in this guy, he's 18 years old, he's driving a Mercedes Benz, he got big gold chain, diamond rings all over the place. What does he do for a living?
The great divide between the haves and the have-nots got wider in the 1980s. In the world outside the ghetto, there were now new legal ways to get rich quick. Reaganomics had achieved its goal. Inflation had been stopped. With regulations reduced and interest rates lowered, Wall Street exploded. This was the beginning of the roaring 80s.
When I started brokering government bonds, I was 23 years old. I was making $75,000 a year.
Chris Burke, a former waiter with a high school education, went to Wall Street and joined a new class of wealthy, young, urban professionals. In the acronym of the time, he was a yuppie.
When I would come in at 7:30 in the morning with a trench coat, and I'd have a phone, and I'd have two phones in my ear, I could get my coat off until 10 o'clock in the morning. Literally. I mean, it was, back then, it was wild.
By 2 p.m., the roar in the bond trading room, fueled more by fear than greed, was unearthly. They all shouted and sweated and swore and devoured their electric donuts.
The heady times were described in Tom Wolfe's The Bonfire of the Vanities, the novel of the 80s.
Interest rates a half, 10,000 by 10,000, kid are taking it up.
Extraordinary percentages of the graduates, the top graduates, at Harvard, Yale, Princeton, we're heading for Wall Street. No longer are they going to be doctors or lawyers. They're going to go straight to this great cornucopia where there was money practically floating in the air.
There was no place in America, small or large, where a company couldn't be a target for a corporate raider. Corporate raiders were looking for companies to buy and then sell off their assets. In Williamsport, Pennsylvania, a small dairy company with a string of convenience stores became the target of a hostile takeover.
It struck me as incredible that someone with a stack of paper, a stack of legal documents, and a bank behind him could come in and steal a company away from a community and away from the people who worked so hard to build it. It just didn't make sense.
Keith Sterkula was working for his father, the CEO of Foodcraft, Inc., when the raider visited the company.
It was the beginning of deer season in Pennsylvania, which is a national holiday in Pennsylvania. This guy came in dressed as a hunter. The company was a target, and he was a big game hunter.
Farmers, dairy workers, store clerks, almost 1,000 people depended on Foodcraft for a living. The entire city of Williamsport was worried.
People would come up and express sympathies, almost as if someone had died.
The company fought back, trying to persuade every individual shareholder not to sell to the raider. A year and a half later, at a shareholders meeting in 1986, the company's fate was decided.
It's kind of like the Academy Awards, where it's like somebody's going up there and opening up an envelope, and you don't know what the outcome's going to be. I thought the company was going to go. And I looked over at my father, and he had his poker face. And the votes were coming in, and we realized that we had won. I said, you know, David beat Goliath in this one.
It was the exception, of course. Many wage earners were crushed, and many companies destroyed in the greatest wave of corporate takeovers in American history. In the early 1980s, American confidence in the future found a powerful symbol in the space shuttle. It made its maiden flight in 1981.
The space shuttle, at 2,000 tons fully fueled, is virtually the size and the length and the weight of a World War II destroyer. But if you took a World War II destroyer and turned it up on its fantail, that is the scale of the space shuttle.
Malcolm McConnell was a journalist who covered the shuttle for Reader's Digest.
11, 10, we are go for main engine ignition.
7, 6,
6. We have main engine ignition. 3, 2, 1, and solid motor ignition and liftoff. Liftoff of the first operational space shuttle mission.